I'll now call the Administration and Public Works Committee of the Evanston City Council to order. We have a quorum, and we'll begin with public speakers. I'd like to remind the public speakers, or actually, we're going to start with the mayor, actually, special order of business. So the mayor's coming in right now.
Thank you very much.
And Daryl's good to work with you.
All right.
Hey, how you doing there?
Good.
All right,
we have a very exciting announcement. It's worth waiting. You start.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, committee members, Deputy Storley. Tonight, we'd like to celebrate the annual National Drinking Water Week third grade art contest. And what we did in celebration of National Drinking Water Week is we contacted third grade classes throughout the city of Evanston, and they drew art representative of the theme, The Power of Water. So tonight, we would like to present the awards to the winners.
First one is Drinking Water Week, third grade art contest, People's Choice Award, Malia G. Shunyoung from Walker Elementary School.
And the art pieces are displayed out in the lobby area there. And also, they get the plaque, the certificate, a drinking National Drinking Water Week Power of Water water bottle, as well as a four set of beach tokens for the beach.
Are we not giving her everything?
No.
Malia, come back. And the next Drinking Water Week third grade art contest, the Mayor's Choice Award, Thalia D. Selch, Lincoln Elementary School. Last but not least, Drinking Water Week, third grade art contest, Water Spirit Award, Susie Tominski, Lincoln Elementary School.
Thank you. Congratulations to all the winners.
You really should take a look at the pictures. They're wonderful.
Encourage everyone to see them outside in the lobby. So we'll now begin with public speakers. I'd like to remind everyone that you have 3 minutes of public testimony. We'll begin with Adrian Castell, followed by Frank Ulus and Hassan Abdi. Is Mr. Castell here? Would you like to speak, Mr. Castell?
Yes, hello. So I just coming for my medallion for Evanston. So that's the Uber just coming over there, but no get no driver. You get no driver. You get nothing for the chauffeur license. But New Jersey stock, they will be coming over there. They don't pay the tax, Everstone tax. But we pay the business license every month, every year. But so we get nothing to do about this. But they will be coming over there, but we get no driver. But the city, you know, ask them city something, you just get something for now. I work for my life. I got him something for my retirement, but I don't want. So I just coming for the city, coming to get something for no about the Uber. Uber just coming over there. Uber no pay the tax. You don't pay nothing. You just coming over there, just pick up people and the invest on, you know, get nothing to do about no. But for no pay for the business license every year. No take care for the city. That's come the medallion cause for the city, invest on. So the Uber just coming over there, pick up everybody here. No get no driver. Just that you just coming over there today. No want to get something for the city. Come and get something help for now. So, I don't know.
Thank you.
Okay, welcome.
Mr. Frank Luz, Hassan Abdi, and Marie Figaro.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
My name is Frank. Well, this I came for my wife. I have my number. She has a number in Evanston. I've been to drive in Evanston like 18 years. I've been retired on 2007. Since that time, I can do nothing. I lose the number. But 7 months ago, they gave me the number back. I can find nobody to list the number. Before they give me the number, 5 months, they didn't pay me. The driver just told me, no business. You can drive, adios. I told him, adios. He give me the number back. I can find nobody since this. So I need the city help to save my number. Thank you.
Thank you. Hassan Abdi, Marie Figaro, and Marie Alden.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I've been a part of North Shore Cab Company for almost about 37 years and have followed all the rules, all the regulations and everything, and the city inspectors will verify. But this Uber thing, it just popped out of nowhere, but I was still kind of confident that, you know, Uber or anyone, we do have the city's backing for our taxi industry. Unfortunately, as much as Mr. Stevens, you know, can try, and he has tried, there's not much has been done. We had a home rule that could very easily be applied to prevent us. We take care of all the senior citizens. We take the coupons from the longest possible rides. And you know, practically everybody in the cab industry of Evanston is almost bankrupt. I know I am. And I don't know which way to turn. And that's why we are here to plead our case. So if possible at all, would you please consider this matter? It's a very, very serious matter. Lots and lots of lives and lots of careers depend on this. So that's all I have to say, that please, seriously, seriously do consider. We have been a part of Evanston, like the Lake Shore. So just don't leave us out there to be devoured by these big, huge giants. Please help us come and protect our rights, and give us a chance to compete, you know, with the quality and everything. And we've been doing this all this time. And I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Marie Figaro, Marie Albin, Marie Therese Augustin.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Marie Figaro. I'm here
mainly to ask the city to help us to amend to amend what we have in the ordinance. Let me give you a little bit of my story. I come to this country with my dream. And first, when my mom come with us, seven of us, we were in a little room, one room, all seven of us. But one thing she say, work hard and you will succeed, which I spent 12 years working downtown. I took my retirement, I took my pension, I invested in the taxi of Evanston. And I didn't expect another product gonna come in and bring everything down like that. So right now, I have to tell you the truth. I don't have pension, I don't have retirement. The only thing I'm hoping to retire is on the Social Security. And my thing is, the ordinance has a quote on it. If you don't renew the license, the city will take your medallion and auction it. And that's what concerning me. I do not have driver. Is not for the past years what I have drivers are always renew on time. Everybody renew on time, but now with lack of driver, we cannot renew. And based on the ordinance, April 30, if you don't renew, they're gonna take your medallion. And right now, some of my medallion, I still owe money, I'm paying the bank. What we're asking is, we ask the city, we're willing to pay for the medallion every year. We're willing to pay for the inspect for everything. But please, do not take the medallion away. Because for me, that was my dream. My dream, I thought like, I got it made. I got it okay, but everything went down the drain. So, please consider, and if they can amend the ordinance for us, just to give us time to look for drivers, because without drivers, we cannot buy cars. And also, remember with Uber, there is no rules, no regulation. We have to go, the driver have to be inspected. Let me give you an idea. It takes $4,000. The insurance costs $4,000 a year for a cab to be on the street. When you put a cab out, you have to pay 20% of that $4,000. You have to pay inspection. You have to paint. You have to come for inspection with Mr. Steve. You have to go inspection based on the rules. The driver have to get the fingerprint. Everything is a lot of rules, and Uber is running without rules. So I know that right now my main concern is mostly, for the city to help us to amend the ordinance, so give us time to look for drivers. Don't take our dream away. For me, it will take my dream away. So please consider that for us. Amend that quote that say that by April 30, they will take our medallion away from us and put it on auction. So I don't think none of us can live with it. Everybody is working so hard, 20 years. For me, I worked 12 years downtown, and I took everything I have, because I believe in the taxi industry in Evanston. And, well, another product coming, what can I do? So please consider that for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Marie Albin, Marie Therese Augustin, and then Tataki Ronald.
Hi, my name is Marie Edith Albin. My husband was dead. I got a boy, 16 years old. I am there when I'm a single mom. I need help, please. So I need somebody help me about with my number. Do you know, I don't got a person to drive my car, my number. So I cannot pay my bill. So I really, really, really need help. Somebody help me about with the number. I don't, the number go away, take away from me, because it's gonna be so hard for me. And I can't pay my bill, and I don't got it. No way to sleep with my son, 16 years old. Please, I need help. Thank you so much for it.
Thank you. Marie Therese Augustin, Tataki Ronald, and then Martin Cadet.
Good evening. My name is Marie Augustin. I work 20 years in a Western hospital, and I was sleeping. I get the money they give it to me for retired, you know, for pension. I buy the number. Donc, now I don't have no driver. Donc, I need some place to live. I need to pay my place. If I don't pay, they're going to put me out. I'm going to be in shelter. And you know, I leave my country to work so hard and here. I can't live, you know, my life. My husband died. I have my first son. He died at 29. I bury my husband. I bury my son. I adopt my granddaughter because she's in Haiti. She can't eat. She can't go to school. I have to get her. But now I don't have nothing. I just need your help if you can't help me because I don't like to pay to lose the number. What I'm going to do? I can't live in shelter. Even when I live in Haiti, I don't live in shelter, you know. But now that's very hard. I don't have no help. Please, thank you.
Thank you. Tataki Ronald and then Martin Cadet.
Good evening. My name is Wano Tatali. I live in Evanston for the last 20 years, and then I've been in the business for the last 18 years. I put all my money and my wife's money on the business, taxi business. But the problem is now we cannot find driver because Uber. And then that's why we're here. We ask for her help. Thank you.
Thank you. Finally, Martin Cadet.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
My name is Martin Cadet. I've been working in Evanston for the past 14 to 17 years doing taxi. And the glory of doing that thing, I end up in this sick way. So I did a stroke, but now I'm not driving anymore. But my number is my quotidian bread. So I can't drive now. But if the years is coming, I have to drive, I don't know what I will do. But for some reason, I heard they got another company who come in as a global and try to put us out of the way. So we have many drivers here, and all those people you see around here, they are fighting to survive. And you all know what a survivor is. So the business go down because of the numbers. Just imagine if a big company coming on our way now and try to say, Evanston, you no longer need your help. So what we're going to say, you all Evanstonian, when you get up in the morning, you need a taxi. You need a cab to whatever to take you someplace else. With respect, we are by your door. And the next thing we do, we salute you, and we take you to your place. I think that's the best way we deal as a society, and we respond as a society. But they got one thing we got to put an order now. If a big company come in and try to flush us out because of the volume and because of the quantity, whatever they have, so the Evanstonian people, the Evanstonian people going to do one thing, what they're going to use for their service. Remember, we're getting old every day. We're not getting younger. So for that reason, I do ask you one thing. You, the representative of this company, to do your best and to serve us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Alderman Rainey.
Mr. Chair, and members of the committee, I think we have an urgent situation here, and I'm going to propose an immediate moratorium on rescinding medallions if there is no driver for a car, immediately. And secondly, at our very next meeting on our agenda, I would like to move that issues having to do with bringing up the cab companies, not dragging down Uber. You don't put a squash on the innovator. You do things to bring up the longtime operators of the taxi cab companies. So the first thing I hope we do at the special meeting, after we put this moratorium on rescinding the medallions, is that we amend the ordinance as one of the speakers suggested. We amend the ordinance so that perhaps there is an 18-month period where if the cab companies can figure out a way that this will help them, that'll be fine. We should look at some other things too. It was suggested to me earlier that we've not given the cab company an increase in fare prices for a while. Now that flies in the face of the Uber issue because of course Uber is cheaper than the taxis, but there are still people who would never call Uber. They will not use the software. They pick up the phone and they call their favorite cab company. So I think we should look at that too at our next meeting. And perhaps, Mr. Chair, we could ask our legal department. This seems to be an administrative issue of putting a moratorium on rescinding the medallions until there is a driver for the car. But so I'm not sure how that'll work, but I see our chief administrator is here to tell us.
Mr. City Manager.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, good evening. I think certainly we could administratively put that moratorium in place immediately, and we have a presentation later in your agenda. We'd like to make that presentation, and then likely there'll be other direction from the committee at that time, but we can put that moratorium in place administratively, get further direction from you, and come back at your
Alderman Rainey, if you want to, and when we get to that section of the agenda, make the formal request after we have the presentation. Would that work? Or do you want to make it now?
Okay,
without, either way.
Just hold it until
I really hope we can do that.
Yeah. Okay. And again, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, my sense is there may be other directions. So we'll package all that up and then come back at a meeting of your convenience.
Okay, thank you.
My concern is that the moratorium be administered immediately. I don't know that we can put things to vote on our agenda tonight.
I don't believe that you can. Again, the request of the mayor
rescinding the I had no idea that was happening, by the way. Right. I didn't even know that was a condition of the taxi ordinance. So it's really urgent that we do that. It's not hurting anybody. They're looking for drivers. It's not going to hurt anybody.
And Mr. Farrar, the law department administers this. We can send a communication out to the medallion holders of the moratorium. So we can do that over the next couple of days. Many are in the audience tonight.
And, we'll also, do we know of any medallions that have been rescinded in the past few months, let's say, because they didn't have a driver?
I'm unaware of any. I think, as some speakers have said, that there was a date coming up at the end of April. Mr. O'Sullivan, who is our staff member who administers these programs, works for Mr. Farrar, and so we'll make sure that word gets out. But again, this is a larger issue, and would look forward to presenting the information that we've compiled and get additional direction.
Thank you. Alderman Braithwaite.
Thank you, Alderman Miller. And Alderman Rainey, thank you for the suggestion at the appropriate time. I'll definitely second your motion. The other question that I do have for and it may come up in our presentation. Do you have a breakdown? I didn't see it in our packet, a memo of the operational costs for running a taxi cab. So there were a couple of fees that I did see in the memo, but can we have a breakdown of the
Certainly.
Operational costs that are associated with running a taxi cab in Evanston?
And we did not anticipate that we would answer all the questions this evening.
Sure.
It's been a couple of years since the item's been before the council, so we'll gather all that up. Ms. Knapp, who I don't immediately see, but I'm sure is nearby, will make the presentation, and we'll gather up all your questions at that time.
Thank you.
Thank you. So to the agenda, Alderman Braithwaite, I'll accept that a motion for approval of the minutes. Any discussion or changes? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Wynn, do you want to do the bills and the payroll?
Yes. I move approval for item A1. City of Evanston payroll through April 3rd, 2016, $3,010,607.79. And A2, which is fiscal year 2016, City of Evanston bills, April 26, 2016, $2,872,084.97.
Second.
Thank you.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Rainey, A31.
Yes, sir. Renewal with SunGard Public Sector for CAD software license and service agreement in the amount of $69,896. The agreement is effective May 1, 2016 through April 30th, 2017.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Holmes, A32.
Renewal contract with Otis Elevator Company for the elevator services and maintenance. And for 11 elevators at various city facilities in the amount of $60,324.24 for funding year 2016, $60,324.24 for funding year 2017, and $60,324.24 for funding year 2018.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Braithwaite, A33.
Sure. Mr. Chair, I'd like to move item 3.3, renewal contract for testing and repair certification for fire apparatus and aerial devices with Global Energy products, and that's in the dollar amount of $72,300.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Item A3.4 has been withdrawn. Alderman Wynn, item A3.5.
Yes, I move approval of construction engineering and surveying services pre-qualification. Staff recommends City Council authorize the City Manager to approve the following four firms as pre-qualified and eligible to provide construction engineering and surveying services to the City of Evanston. In accordance with RFQ 16-21, Christopher B. Burke Engineering, Gewalt Hamilton Associates, Hampton, Lenzini, and Renwick, and Thompson Engineering Group. The purpose of this request for qualifications is to pre-qualify firms to provide construction engineering services and surveying services for a two-year period from May 2016 through April 2018.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Rainey, A36.
Could you tell me which one was withdrawn?
3.4.
The truck, okay. The replacement truck.
All right. Next is 3.6, Dodge Avenue Bike Lane Construction Engineering Services Contract with HLR Inc. This is in the amount of $30,728.07. Available funding is $29,143, but we have $1,585 left over from the Church Street project. And, Mr. Chair and members of the committee, this is only for engineering being required by the grant we have to do the construction. The engineering services are not included in the grant award. I move approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Holmes, A37.
A3.7 sole source purchase was Ozinger Ready Mix Concrete Incorporated for concrete in the amount of $63,100. Funding for this purchase will be the following: $49,900 out of the general fund, $7,600 out of the water fund, and $7,600 out of the sewer fund.
Second.
Mr. Stoneback, if no one else has any questions, just one quick question.
Good evening, Dave Stoneback, Public Works Agency Director.
So we just, based on our projected capital needs for the year, we just estimate how much we're going to need based on this contract and...
That's correct. These are estimated quantities per cubic yard. We estimate how many yards we're going to need, and that's how we devise the total funding limit.
And we've hit this number in the past when we've done these sort of contracts?
We've generally been under. We want to make sure we don't have to come back and ask for more.
When the season started.
Any further discussion? Thank you. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. So we're on, was it Alderman Holmes? No, you just did that one.
It's 3.8 for Alderman Braithwaite.
Alderman Braithwaite, you're next. A3.8.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I'd like to move item 3.8, contract with Smith Group JJR for Church Street South Pier reconstruction, and that's in the amount of $80,000.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Wynn, A3.9.
The staff recommends City Council authorize the City Manager to approve a contract with Patriot Pavement Maintenance in the amount of $70,000. Patriot Pavement Maintenance was the lowest responsive bidder for the 2016 Municipal Partnership Initiative Crack Sealing Contract. Funding for this work will come from the General Fund Street Maintenance Account.
Your second?
Yes, and I move.
Second.
Thank you.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Rainey, A310.
A310. Request to recommend to the City Council a contract with Lakeshore Recycling Systems for condo waste management. This is an additional one-year period through October 31st, 2017. And the amount is, what's the amount? Is there an amount on here?
Let me check.
No, it didn't have it in there.
I think it's per unit or something. Right, that's what it is. All right, so I move approval.
Second.
It's $6.49 per unit. Yeah, $6.49 per unit.
So it's approximately $1, is that right?
If you look at it, it's in the what was in our packet.
Right. Any further discussion?
Page 132.
Page 132. Further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed, say nay. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Holmes, A311.
Change order number 2 with Carol Lowe, Engineer Incorporated for engineering services for the Evanston Water Utility 48-inch diameter intake improvement, RFP 12-113. In the not to exceed amount of $3,892, increasing the amount from $160,658 to $164,550. This change order will also extend the contract completion date by 411 days from March 31, 2015 to May 15, 2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Braithwaite, A312.
Yes, Mr. Chair. I'd like to move item A312, change order number 4 with Lake Erie Diving Inc. for the 48-inch diameter water intake improvements, bid number 14-04.
And second.
Go ahead.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Discussion, Alderman Holmes?
Well, because there's an increase in the amount, maybe we should read that.
Oh, yes, yeah, so 69, yeah. In the amount of $69,161.52.
And keep going.
Yeah, so the original amount was $1,444,196, and that increases it to $1,513,357.52.
Further discussion?
And that was just for the audience, because it increases the amount and also the time of the contract.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Alderman Holmes.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed, nay. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Braithwaite, A4.
I just did.
Oh, you did A4. I'm sorry. Yeah. Alderman Wynn, A4.
Yes. Staff recommends approval of Resolution 21-R16, authorizing the city manager to sign a local agency agreement with IDOT for the Central Street Bridge Phase 1 project. The agreement establishes the maximum grant funding at 80%, not to exceed $352,000. The negotiated final cost for Phase 1 engineering study is $438,100, of which 80% will be funded from a federal grant from the Surface Transportation Program, Bridge Program, and $87,700 from the city's Capital Improvement Program, General Obligation Bonds. This is for action. I move for action.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Rainey, A5.
Yes, this is related to the previous resolution. It's Resolution 28-R16, authorizing the manager to sign a preliminary services agreement with IDOT and professional services agreement with Stanley Consultants for the Central Street Bridge Phase 1 engineering study. The engineering study is $438,100, which $350,400 or 80% will be funded by a federal grant from the Surface Transportation Program, Bridge Program, and the remaining from the city's Capital Improvement Program. Move approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Holmes, A6.
Resolution 30-R-16. Northwestern University utility easement on Chicago Avenue. Staff recommends that the City Council adopt Resolution 30-R-16, authorizing the city manager to grant an easement for chilled water pipe installation on Chicago Avenue to Northwestern University. The easement will be granted for a 50-year period. Northwestern will fund the project and will be assessed a one-time easement fee, of $58,035.21.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Braithwaite, A7.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd like to move item A7, Resolution 31-R16, Northwestern University Utility Easement on Emerson Street.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Nguyen, A8.
Yes, this is Resolution 33-R16. This is a lease agreement for the Noyes Street Theater at the Noyes Cultural Center with Mudlark Theater Company. The collected theater revenue is budgeted in the business unit, and the theater's 2016 monthly rental rate would be $3,060. Mudlark Theater Company is required to do $3,672 in community services no later than May 31, 2017.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Rainey, A9.
Resolution 29-R16, authorizing the city manager to negotiate and execute a residential leases for two apartments located at 631 Howard Street. These are renewals for the tenants in two of the units.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Holmes, A10.
A10, Resolution 35-R-16, approving the short sale of 2424 Dempster, the Chicken and Waffles, Chicago's Chicken and Waffles, to a new buyer and action related thereto. The short sale, let's see, this will be a short sale. Chicken and Waffle closed its business at 2424 Dempster in 2015. It proposes to sell the property and request a payoff letter related to the $200,000 Economic Development Fund loan given to it by the City of Evanston. Chicken and Waffles proposes to pay $59,832.36 on the loan mortgage, leaving a remaining deficit owing to the city of $154,346.55. Move approval.
Second.
Alderman Rainey.
In thinking about this, I definitely want to get this occupied, and it appears as though there is a buyer waiting in the wings. Do we know what the actual sales price agreed to, or is that confidential?
It's in the HUD documents. I think it was $560,000, if that's
right. $554,000, I think.
$50,000.
Mm-hmm. No, the sale price.
The
price that the new owner is going to pay. That's what I'm looking for.
Yeah, I believe that's correct, Mr. Chair, members of the committee.
$540,000.
Okay. Do we know what the mortgage, the remaining balance of the mortgage short of the city's loan is on that property?
It says on if you look on page 287, first bank, it's $186,632.79. And then their taxes.
What page is that, Dolores?
287. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe somewhere else, but I see it on 287.
Yeah.
Okay, keep going.
See it?
I saw this. I didn't.
And then there's a taxes, and then there's a seller's credit property, owner's policy for $2,305, and then the $32,183.11. All totals up to be $540,000. I think that's correct.
It says that line item 504, Alderman Rainey, is payoff of first mortgage loan to First Bank and Trust is $186,732.
So $186,6.
Mm-hmm.
There's no money in here for us, right?
Well, I have a couple questions related, if I may, Alderman Rainey.
Do that, please.
So can someone talk to me about the property taxes that are left payable? So it looks here that there's $32,000, roughly, in county property taxes for roughly the last year. Can anyone talk to that?
I don't believe we have any staff available. Oh, no.
Well, we sure don't want anybody buying those taxes.
Well, I looked up earlier today the property taxes, and the most recent tax sale is this wasn't listed for sale. So my understanding is that there's no outstanding property taxes. Is that correct on the property?
Mr. Farr.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, based upon the information we have right now, the back taxes owed are approximately $32,000 as reflected on the HUD one.
So in essence, we're looking at first bank and trust will be paid off with $186 roughly. They'll pay off the county taxes for $32,000. So in essence, rounding that up, that's roughly $250,000, give or take. So where's the extra $250,000 going to? And this is in essence going back to the, if the bank's being paid off, this is going to the seller for the extra $540. I'm sorry, it's almost $290,000.
Looking at page 288 of the packet, if you look at the HUD 1 statement, there's a number of year installment taxes owed. It's 1305 is the line item. That all those back taxes owed for the borrower's failure to timely pay, as reflected on the HUD 1, is $194,562.
But these haven't been sold, right?
I'm not aware of that right now.
So who would be paying? Who is going to pay that $200,000? Where is that going in the sense of the taxes that's, haven't been sold?
That's coming out of the HUD one. That's what the buyer is proposing to pay as a condition of the transaction.
My understanding is, I don't know if anyone can answer this, that I looked online, for example, it's not going to be at the next tax sale, this property. Is that correct? So, I mean, if we have outstanding taxes from 2012, 2013, who are we paying that money to if the taxes haven't been sold? Do we know if those have been sold at all?
We have no information on that. And the buyer has not been willing to give us a completely accurate portrait of all of that. That's been one of the issues. This is what he proposed to us through his attorney.
So, and then my understanding is they have a closing date of, is it the 27th?
So it moved the closing date back, yes.
To the 27th of?
To accommodate for, yes, April 27th, to accommodate for the scheduling of this meeting.
Because if that $200,000 roughly, if we don't know if that's not going to someone that bought the taxes, you know, we don't know exactly where that's going. That's potentially, you know, what is our loan in a sense. So I'd like to know if there's any, what's happened with the 2012, 2013, and I think, like I said, the 2014 tax sale list I've looked at, and I don't believe it's on that list. I'd like to find out what's happened with those back taxes before I make a decision on this.
Well, if they held it for this meeting, is this time sensitive in terms of us trying to get it taken care of? For me, the biggest thing is to get that building open again.
Respectfully, and business, I mean, they can push closing.
Pardon me?
They can push closing.
Oh, okay.
I mean, you know.
Okay.
I don't see why there's any reason, especially if this is an outstanding issue that they can't close without us, so they can push closing on this. So I don't know if you want to hold this for the meeting until we find out what's going on with this, but I until we find out what's going on with the $200,000, I'm not comfortable voting on it. So, Alderman Braithwaite?
I think in speaking to or hearing from the bank, this is time sensitive, Mr. Chair. And my understanding is the seller's the buyer is very concerned about the timeliness. And so my understanding is if we delay or hold, it does jeopardize the deal. Although I do understand your questions, and it's difficult to understand if we're talking about taxes and taxes is public information, why there's even a question at hand. But. Mm-hmm.
Alderman Rainey?
I'm not sure how long these negotiations have been going on, but if they've been going on for a long time, is there a threat on the part of the buyer that they're out of here if we don't do something? I'm just concerned
right.
If that's the deal.
And Alderman Rainey, members of the committee, I think in any property transaction, all parties are always anxious. And I think all parties are anxious. This has been discussed with us. There was a closing date that was a couple months back that did not happen. This date has been moved to the month. So I think it's fair to say that all parties are anxious. First Bank and Trust, which is a party to this, has certainly communicated to the city their desire to move forward with this. So, but again, I think there's the larger policy question for the council. This is a lot of money. There are different things to be weighed here, and really the staff is putting forward to you what has been put forward to us.
Well, can I continue?
Yeah.
I dread saying this, seeing that there's a campaign coming up, but I'm not concerned about the amount of money. What I'm concerned about is if the seller, and we're excusing the seller of a loan that we gave them, if the seller is going to recoup a couple $100,000 from this sale, and yet we're forgiving him, what, $180,000 or something? I mean, that's my only concern here, only concern. Is there any way we can do this and go after that money if we find out that these taxes aren't due to somebody? I mean, that's my only concern.
And Mr. Chair, Alderman Rainey, the Law Department has done some due diligence on the status of the entity that purchased the property. Mr. Farr, would you care to share what our knowledge is of that?
Yes. Part of the problem with respect to the seller is that their corporate status was revoked by the Illinois Secretary of State late 2014, early 2015, which is about the time that the liquor licensing issues popped up on the radar. So it's been very, very difficult to get straight information from the seller on any issue, and that has really, unfortunately, hamstrung our ability to piece together the true substance and nature of this transaction.
Alderman Holmes?
I want to be clear that I understand what you're raising, Alderman Miller. You're saying that you think somebody bought the old taxes? Is that what you're saying? It might be the buyer? I mean, it might be the seller?
I looked at the list for the upcoming tax sale of 2014, and this property isn't listed in the tax sale. And, you know, if we don't know if there's the 2012, 2013, if those taxes have been paid off or not, I'm just wondering where this $200,000 is going. You know, if looking at the list in 2014, it's not on the list to be sold. So if it's not in 2014, I'm wondering what's going on with 2012 and 2013 as well. So in the first installment, 2015, by the way, I know, for example, that if you look at the treasurer's website, actually, I assume the bank, there's a property management company that's been paying the taxes. So if the 2015 taxes are being redeemed in that $200,000 amount as well, then I don't know why we're paying that as well.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, the Corporation Council has the ability to do this research right now.
Okay.
So if you'd like, we could, there's other matters before the committee, we could table this for a little bit. Finish the committee agenda and come back to this at the end of the committee meeting prior to going on to the full council. If Mr. Farr has that information at that time, then you can consider it or decide other action.
Okay. Well, Alderman Rainey, sure.
When there's this situation with a bank and there are outstanding taxes, doesn't the bank protect its interests by paying the taxes?
Traditionally, yes.
There are various scenarios. I think banks protect their interests.
So the bank could have paid these taxes.
Correct.
They could.
That's a real possibility here.
So
will we? One other question.
Sure.
Will we be at the closing?
We will be. Yes.
Okay. Can changes be made at the closing when if it gets to that point and we find out what you're going to research?
Well, I am looking at some correspondence that was exchanged between Deputy City Attorney Ms. Mason Cup and the attorney for Chicken and Waffles last week, and we clarified with the attorney, the seller's attorney, that and confirmed that he did not send in copies of a tax deed petition, that there has been no petition filed for the tax deed, the back taxes. And it was the seller's attorney's suggestion that they did not want to wait. It's their position that they want every tax liability attendant to this property satisfied through the sale. That is their position. We, of course, as a matter of pattern and practice, don't necessarily agree with that statement.
There you go.
So it's the buyer. it.
But we still don't know if there's actually any taxes owed on this. So in essence, I mean.
Okay.
As far as we can tell, we've been able to verify that the taxes are still owed. The fact that they haven't been put up for sale yet, there's been no petition filed for the redemption. But that's what they're representing to the tile company. And that's, again, the information that we've been able to piece together through many different sources.
Well, I mean, here's the thing. We're holding up this sale in essence. So I don't understand why the pressure's on us to do this. I mean, if they want to get this deal done, they're going to have to get more information to us, is the way I see it. Because this is still uncertain to me. I mean, I can't support this as it currently stands. I don't know if there's any further discussion. Alderman Rainey?
But isn't the bank the one with all the information? I mean, hasn't Chicken and Waffles been out of this for a while?
Yeah.
I mean, so what do they know? I mean, they're just telling us whatever will shut us up.
And, sorry, I've been neglecting Alderman Wynn. My apologies.
Well, I think I share the concerns of, everyone up on this committee, but I agree I would like to get the property usable and working again. But I also agree with Alderman Rainey. I want to find out if, well, I agree with Alderman Miller. We need a lot more information. And if they need us to close, then they have to give us the information. But I also agree with Alderman Rainey. I'd like to find out if, so that the corporation has been dissolved, but what other methods or assets can we pursue?
And we could come back and report on that.
To find out if we could get our money back. I mean, I'd like to get this parcel sold if there's someone interested in it, but I also would like to find out if there is some money available for us if we pursue it.
Certainly. And the principals own two additional restaurants, one in Bronzeville and one in Oak Park. We discovered today in doing some additional research that there are about $34,000 of unpaid taxes on the Oak Park location. Is that the proper number off the top of my head?
That is correct. Their other entity owns a business in Oak Park. However, the problem with that is it's owned by a different corporation. Mm-hmm. So there has been some care taken with respect to the allocation of the assets by this seller.
And so we could do additional work. The law department could get a Dun & Bradstreet report, which would help us, I think, unmask a little bit more of the corporate structures involved here. So all that diligence could be done at the council's direction.
Well, I think that we should spend some hours finding out about that because obviously it's a large sum of money. And if there is, they may have been very careful, but you know, it's still worthwhile for us to check to see if there are some assets that could help us in this situation.
Any further discussion?
We're going to come back to this, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think prior have you discovered the information that you think you have, that you need as far as the tax information, the emails from the attorney, or is there additional Cook County information that would?
I think there's another level of due diligence that we can pursue along with the Dun & Bradstreet and other matters that can shed some light on both the actual framework of the transaction and also the advisability of pursuing other assets.
But not this evening?
Dun & Bradstreet's going to take at least a week to get back to me.
Okay, and there's no other online ask?
I can do some checking, but in the flow of the meeting, it's going to be a little difficult.
So, Mr. Chair, I think you have a couple of options. You can just table it right now and take it to your next meeting. We could see if there's additional information Mr. Farr has been able to come up with in the next 15, 20 minutes until the end of the committee meeting.
My preference would be to at least hold it the next meeting or table it. Alderman Rainey?
Well, I want to deal with this as a separate project. I don't want to go after their other assets for their, you know, restaurant in Bronzeville or anything. This was a deal we made with them and a loan we made on this property. I'd like to keep it specific to this property. And my only concern is that these taxes haven't been paid by the bank or bought by some other entity. That's my only concern.
And again, we can continue to do some due diligence this evening. Likely it will take additional time beyond that.
But we can hope. I mean, we still have several more items that's going to take a few minutes. to
I think
to
it probably, we have to check with what's going on with the back taxes, if they've been sold or not. I don't know if that can be done tonight or not, but I mean, I wouldn't be comfortable moving forward until we know the status of the tax liabilities on the property.
Mr. Chair, we'll follow your direction.
Since we have nothing scheduled for the first Monday in May, could we have a special
sure.
council meeting
so that we can deal with councils.
Taxes and you know this.
We have the Human Services is scheduled to meet in its regular time, and I believe that meeting is moving forward. So
sure.
that would meet, I believe, at 6 p.m. Mm-hmm. So if the council wished to have a one-item agenda for that Monday at 6 o'clock, and
two
then
items. Taxis and we could do taxis and this.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I guess I'm less willing to commit to taxis right at this moment, not knowing what you're going to ask us yet. So, but certainly we could come back. I think, Mr. Farrar, a week's time is sufficient to gather additional details of the Dun & Bradstreet we can order tomorrow.
Is our next Rules Committee, City Manager?
The Rules Committee no longer has a fixed time. The City Council amended its rules a couple months back. So,
that's right. I should know that.
So I'll entertain a motion to hold it to a date certain.
I think before I vote, I just want to make sure, depending on whatever the bank, of course, communicated to our staff, if for any reason we hold this and delay it, will it jeopardize the loan?
You know, there are multiple parties involved. I think the purchaser has been involved with this property for quite some time. I don't know that we have a absolute yes or no. Mr. Farrar, I don't think you – do you have any additional information?
I've not spoken to the buyer. I've only been interfacing with the seller in terms of the seller's insistence upon moving this transaction forward.
And again, as I mentioned before, I think that this is akin to any other property transaction. People are anxious to be concluded, but obviously there are unanswered questions on the city side.
So I think there's the consensus is to hold it. Can I have a motion to hold it till May 2nd, I believe it is. Second. Does anyone want to make that motion?
And if I may, just to from a parliamentary perspective, if you wish the council to act on it.
Well, it's still, I mean, it won't come out. If we could approve it and move it towards the council, but it's still stuck in administrative public works. So we'd have to have a committee meeting on the 2nd.
So we'd have to have 2 meetings then on Monday, which, again, you may certainly do. Or you could move it forward and request that the council hold it and then just have it held at council.
Yeah, I think that would be better.
To the first Monday in May. Mm-hmm.
And then have a special meeting, a special city council meeting a week from today on May the 2nd.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the motion is to approve. So this is approve recommending it to go to the council.
Move introduction.
Move for
second. Okay, there's a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, in the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Alderman Braithwaite, A11.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I'd like to move item A11, Ordinance 45-0-16, Sale of Surplus Property Fleet Vehicles.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Wynn, A12.
Adoption of Ordinance 43016, amending the city code related to the fee structure for collection and disposal of refuse for condominiums. Move
second.
Approval.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Alderman Rainey, A13.
Ordinance 37016, we're being asked to introduce an amendment to the city code regarding special pickup fees, increasing the fee to $60, and then some incremental increases after that, because we are not covering the cost of special pickups.
Is there a presentation on this, Mr. Stoneback, with leave?
Good evening, Chair and committee members. Dave Stomach, Public Works Agency Director. We were talking about special pickups previously. We identified that the cost to provide this is $746,000, most of which is from tipping fees. We did contact both Groot and Lakeshore to ask their price to pick this up and their labor and equipment costs were higher than the city's. Therefore, we think that we want to keep it with the city. This slide indicates that our current fee structure only generates about $87,000 a year. We believe that this is way too low. I want to make you aware that if we wanted to fully recover our cost to provide this program, we would have to charge $60 a cubic yard and have 3 cubic yards as a minimum charge, or $180, and then charge $60 for each additional cubic yard. That would generate the cost to fully fund the program. That sounds very high to what we have, but we also did some research that you can buy a 3 cubic yard bag at Home Depot for $30 and then fill it up in your front lawn and then call Waste Management to come pick it up. And Waste Management would pick it up for $176. So your total cost is $206. So if we went with our full cost recovery here, it would be $180. We'd be cheaper than that methodology. And it get actually, Evanston would be cheaper for the more debris that you would throw out there. So that is the full cost recovery. We don't think that that's actually a very, that's too much of a jump to try to do all at one time. So staff is recommending that we increase the charge to $60 for the first 3 cubic yards and then $10 for each additional cubic yard. So that would generate about $216,000 annually, which would help us start in a process of trying to recover our full cost for this. We would likely come back to council a couple years, every other year or so, in suggesting that this be increased. If this ordinance was passed, we would implement the new fee beginning June 1st so that we have time to put the word out to the residents that this fee is increasing and make them aware of it.
Ben Holmes?
This actually came up, not the increase of fee, but the special pickups came up at my ward meeting last Thursday. We were actually discussing how to make our neighborhoods better. And one of the issues, of course, is overflowing garbage cans and, you know, the rats and all of that that it comes with. And some of the residents were saying that, you know, especially on the rental units, you would see a lot of these overflowing garbage cans because they just never have enough. And so the answer is real simple, get another container, except landlords don't necessarily do that. And also seniors, if they say, for instance, if you have a two flat, maybe the seniors live in one and the other one, and the overflowing causes for another can to be bought, they just don't do that. And what I'm wondering, when we're looking at cost, I don't know how much the garbage cans cost, and I know a lot of people moved from the 95 down to the 65. Is that what?
That's correct.
And what would be the difference? I mean, are we making more? I understand the fee and the increase, and I just wonder, will we ever be able to collect? But would it be simpler if we maybe found some way to add second garbage cans to folk who needed them, to see if that worked with a lesser fee than the whole cost of replacement, maybe only half of that for a second can that would help with the overflowing? Because that's where the problem comes with some of the special pickups, except for fly dumping, which is a whole nother issue.
A lot of the special pickups, though, are sofas and mattresses and things like that that you're not going to get into into a cart.
Right.
I don't think a cart can hold 3 cubic yards. The city does make available additional carts. The second one can be 65 gallon, but the first one has to be 95 gallon.
I'm not saying that. I understand that. But you may need 2 95s. And all I'm saying, could the second 95 be at a lesser fee than what? And I'm not even sure what that is anymore.
And I'm sorry, I'm not prepared for that question.
I know, and I
hear know what the first
but I mean,
card
I'm
is.
I'm just asking something. Can we begin to think about that? Because if that would help relieve some of this. Now, this, I'm just giving you some feedback from what residents said last week. And I, of course, it was all mixed in with overflowing garbage and rats and special pickups where people will sometimes, if you live in an apartment, people will move out and leave chairs and stuff that's sort of stuffed down into the 95-gallon because it'll fit. You know, a regular chair like that will go in there and all the other stuff, particularly where students live on the east side of the ward. And I, if you look at the report that we get every week, I mean, I have more special pickups, I think, than anyone in the city, in the 5th Ward. And it's both on the east side and the west side of the ward.
Right.
Alderman Holmes, I do have some information from the city website. The first wheeled cart is 95 gallons, $17.95 per month, and any additional wheeled cart is $7.95 per month. So it is about half as much for the second cart, and each additional cart thereafter. So if you had four carts, it would be $17.95 plus $7.95 plus $7.95 plus $7.95.
So $7.95, you get, okay, all right.
It's already, we're already offering the half off.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Alderman Nguyen?
Well, Alderman Holmes, our city inspectors can require a landlord, because I've had this in my ward any number of times, where we have rental units or even condos that have insufficient waste receptacles of a, you know, both sorts. And the city can require them. If they go out and see that there is this overflowing problem, they can require them to have an additional cart. And sometimes with restaurants, we have required them to do additional pickups as well. So I think in instances where landlords aren't, you know, if there is an instance where landlords aren't aware that they need to provide more garbage barrels, then we can tell them that they need it and require them to do that as like a matter of our code. So I think that would be something to add onto that list of, you know, because that does happen.
Yeah, well, we had property standards there last Thursday as well. And I'm aware, because I don't have a lot of business in my area, but I do know that we've been able to do that. And I've not had as many problems with businesses as I do with the residential areas is where I have the special pickup issues. And I don't know if people come from other wards and fly up over in the 5th Ward or not. And I'm real serious when I say this, because people come around with those trucks and the next thing you know, you have lots and lots of garbage left. And people get very upset about it, because then it appears on their water bill that they have to pay for it. If you remember, Alderman Breathway and I were talking about cameras that could be portable cameras that could be used where the residents could show people actually fly dumping in their area. So it's a big problem in my ward.
Alderman Holmes, there has been one tire appeared in my alley about 3 weeks ago. I called it in, got it picked up. A second tire appeared last week. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if I'm going to get all four tires mm-hmm. eventually in my alley. Mm-hmm. So similar issues happen. But I do have to say, I do see residents in my ward who put out a sofa and then it sits there. And I, you know, we even put the notice on it. And then I call in and just say, you know, provide a special pickup here, because no one's coming to get that sofa. And, you know, in the city, you know, we need to have, people just can't expect to put out a sofa and have the city pick it up for nothing, you know. I mean, they really do need to
understand that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Alderman Rainey?
Everything's been said.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay, thank you. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. And we have a presentation regarding item APW1. This is the city regulation of taxis and shared ride services.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, Katie Knapp, our Transportation and Mobility Coordinator, has put together the staff report that you have in the packet and a brief presentation. I want to be careful that we don't go over ground that perhaps we've already talked about, so I'm going to ask Katie to sort of more quickly go through her slides so that you can get to whatever direction and whatever scheduling you'd like for that. But I want to thank Katie. The analysis that was in the staff report is really excellent, and in the interest of time, we're going to scoot over some of the slides, but I don't want to lessen the impact of a really great presentation by Ms. Knapp. So Katie, welcome.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, and Assistant City Manager Storley. I'm Katie Knapp, the city's Transportation and Mobility Coordinator, and I'm here to this evening to present a brief and quick overview of the transportation network provider and taxi regulations within the city of Evanston. At this time, staff is seeking further direction on the city's desired approach to taxi regulations. This presentation will cover TMP and taxi regulations at the state and local levels, the city's subsidized taxi program very briefly, and changes in the on-demand ride industry, which include taxis and TMP such as Uber and Lyft. Looking first to TNPs, the State of Illinois Transportation Network Providers, or TMP Act, defines as of June 2015 TMP, TMP drivers, and the moments when TMP services begin and end. At this point, I'll hold on further details of the TMP Act unless there are questions at the end. In February 2015, City Council adopted Regulation 16R15 regarding adoption of state and Illinois standards for TMP resolutions. This reiterates that any TMP operating in the city of Evanston shall, without exception, comply with state and federal laws in its operations. Beyond state and local regulations, TMPs also enforce their own business practices. For example, TMPs such as Uber and Lyft require that their drivers provide their own vehicle, which may include a taxi cab, to perform services. Speaking now to taxi regulations, under the state of Illinois, there are relatively few taxi regulations. The Illinois Secretary of State issues distinctive registration plates for every passenger vehicle used as a taxi cab, and it determines appropriate for-hire displays for vehicles. Municipalities, though, such as the City of Evanston, play a much larger role. The City of Evanston regulates taxis operating in Evanston by way of issuing taxi vehicle licenses and chauffeur driver licenses and establishing taxi operational regulations. The city's annual taxi vehicle license fee is $250. In renewing the taxi vehicle license, the license holder needs to provide proof of the taxi's insurance and vehicle details. The holder is not required to identify a driver when renewing their taxi vehicle license. The renewal license fee is due on January 2nd of each year. If payment is not received by February 15th, a $125 penalty is imposed. Taxi drivers pay $141 in one-time fees for their original chauffeur's driver's license. This includes the application fee, an in-state criminal background check, and a classroom training operated by the city. The training covers such items as customer service and the city's geography and traffic regulations. Additionally, each year, taxi drivers must provide proof of an annual physical. Following the first year, taxi drivers pay $20 a year to renew their chauffeur driver's license. The city's taxi operations include maximum taxi vehicle age, establishment of taxi cab zones, use of a taxi meter, and rate and charges schedules. Evanston's taxi regulations and fees are comparable to those of the City of Chicago, Village of Wilmette, and Village of Skokie. Outside of the state and local regulations, the taxi industry uses varying business practices to structure taxi vehicle license leases between taxi vehicle license holders and taxi drivers. Historically, many taxi vehicle license holders relied upon the taxi drivers to provide a cab and insurance, which the holder could then identify when renewing their taxi vehicle license. Currently, such holders who do not use their own taxi or hold the vehicle insurance are unable to renew their license as they are experiencing difficulties in securing a driver with a taxi and vehicle insurance. The City of Evanston offers a subsidized taxi program for Evanston residents who are over the age of 80 or Evanston residents who are income eligible or over the age of 65 or are an individual with an ambulatory disability. I would be happy to speak more on this item, but sake of time, I'm going to go ahead and move forward.
Answer something though on that, because the one question that I had in terms of the senior taxi coupons, Does Lyft and Uber accept those? I mean, how would you do that? Because don't you have to go online and sign yourself up for those? So how would seniors do that?
Thank you, Alderman. So at this time, Uber and Lyft and other TMPs do not participate in the coupon program. It's okay. Only with taxi cabs. It's also worth noting that the program only allows trips that are taken completely within the City of Evanston boundaries. That's one of the primary reasons in that with working with an outside TMP, it's very hard to structure. In addition to, so for example, we would have to put in a catch that would not allow an individual to register for a trip that went outside of Evanston through Uber and Lyft's platform.
Well, I don't think they're going to take you outside of Evanston for $3 anyway, but yeah. I mean, that's a whole nother. Okay.
Alderman Braithwaite, did you have questions?
Yeah, thank you, Alderman. Ms. Stapp, earlier we heard from a number of taxi cab drivers who was in the audience and that they've actually left, and they shared some very heartfelt stories about lifetime investments. So I heard the fees that you just shared in your report, and there were some fees also in the packet that I read. One of the questions that I had, and again, this is probably before you came in, I'd like to understand the overall cost of what it is for the drivers to operate, as well the value of the medallions. I've heard numbers that range in the thousands. So are we going to get to that information, or is that something that we'll have to wait to receive?
So unfortunately, I do not have the operational cost numbers at this time. We could, though, within a short period of time, probably not tonight, be able to provide data on the cost of the medallions, both within the region and here in Evanston, as those are shared, but they are not directly reported. The cost of what one individual buys a medallion for, what one sells, the city does not directly see, but we hear through conversation.
Okay. And I just recommend, I know Alderman Holmes, you received a request from some of the drivers that was addressed to myself and the mayor asking for an opportunity to meet with the city. Is that something that we can, I think this is one of those situations where we don't want to guess and make assumptions. And if we have a number of people who show up in the audience, it only makes sense to convene a meeting with some of the representatives just to capture that information so we're able to make an informed decision.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Alderman Rainey.
Let's just not delay the path we're on, though.
Oh, I agree. I'm going to support your recommendation. I just would love to have that information.
So this slide is a continuation of the taxi coupon program. Since TMP's arrival here in Evanston in 2013, we have noticed varying changes within the taxi industry, the most primary being noted earlier by comments in the difficulty in securing taxi drivers. Prior to TMP's arrival, there was as many as 2-to-1 drivers to taxi vehicle licenses. There is now a less than a 1-to-1 ratio. There are 140 taxi vehicle licenses issued within the City of Evanston, and there are only 99 registered chauffeur drivers. Additionally, it's worth noting that there is additional competition for chauffeur drivers here within Evanston. Most recently, there's an up-and-coming TMP service called VIA, which exclusively hires individuals with chauffeur licenses. Here we can see the number of individuals with a chauffeur license here in Evanston. You can see the sharp decrease, especially following 2013. As it's been alluded to already in conversation, staff is seeking further direction from the city on the desired approach for taxi regulations. Thank you.
Alderman Rainey.
Katie, does a person have to renew a chauffeur's license every year?
Yes.
And do they do that at the Secretary of State's office?
No, it's through the city of Evanston.
Through the city. Why do they have to renew it every year?
I do not have the answer.
Driver's licenses are good for 4 years. What does it cost to renew your chauffeur's license?
$20 a year.
So it's not earth-shattering.
And that's a fee that we charge? That's the city? Oh, okay.
Mr. Chair and members of the committee, that is a city charge that we have codified. So it would be levied every year, as she said, and could be changed if directed.
Mm-hmm. Alderman Nguyen.
Yes. Katie, can you go back and explain a little bit? You said there's a new entity coming in. Is it VIA?
Yeah.
And so what is their advantage then? Are they saying they have professional drivers? Is that what their point is? This is a whole new company or whatever organization. I wanted to understand what that is. And what do they see as their edge to how does that factor into all of this?
Absolutely. So VIA operates as a shuttle service. So they only use large SUVs of a certain year, color, make, a very kind of more of a standardized fleet. And then they pick up individuals sort of along a route. So not a door-to-door service, but rather we'll meet you at this common intersection, whether it be a library or along a thoroughfare that the car is already traveling. Their goal is to compete with buses and other forms of public transit.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
They also have a $5 flat rate fare, so it's about twice as much as a bus or taking the train, with the idea that you can reserve a seat, they have Wi-Fi, there'll be bottled water. It's for folks who, you know, they kind of have that option, and they're trying to attain that, especially with ride sharing kind of growing an individual trip to trip, but overall carpooling is still quite low here in Evanston and other parts of the country.
So I guess you get on there and you just have to get off wherever you could if you don't have a special stop. Is that?
So it's a prearranged stop with the idea that, you know, if you could walk to the corner or move to the corner and pick up, you're able to reduce overall trip time and getting down to primarily employment centers.
Yeah, like it's like something similar to the megabus.
Like Pace.
Yeah.
It's like Pace.
Right. So would someone, for instance, could you look up their standard route and say, let's say, do they go to O'Hare? And so could you then say, well, I'll just walk to the main library if you live nearby, and there's one of these
shuttles
going out to O'Hare, and it'll only pick up six people. Mm-hmm. So presumably it would be much faster than the Pace bus, which is an hour and a half.
Sure. So VIA is pretty interesting in that it actually works within defined zones.
Okay.
So right now it is only operating in the city of Chicago. It just launched in November 2015. So it's working really between the Lakeview area down towards the Loop, but not in River North, with the idea that you're trying to capture individuals that maybe taking the bus or the train is just a little too long for them. And that they would prefer to have an express service, but they don't want to drive a car themselves.
Okay.
So if their, you know, if their service zone went out to O'Hare, then absolutely, that would be a great way to go.
Okay, I have one more question, and I'm sorry I had to step out for a minute, so you may have answered this. I just heard on the news yesterday that they're, and I don't know which city it was, they're going to be moving towards requiring Uber drivers and Lyft drivers to be fingerprinted. Have you heard about that report, and do you know which city this is?
Yeah, so there's a number of cities that are working towards different security regulations, one of those being even just to the south in Chicago. They actually break it up by how many hours the driver works. So if they work less than 10 hours, they have less of these background check measures, such as fingerprinting, or if they work more than 10, they have additional security measures being placed.
And how did they determine whether you work more than 10 hours?
So that's you know, it's a little bit of a guess, but it's working then with Uber, Lyft, other TMPs. They have to directly report also which trips are being taken, so the actual destination points, who the driver is, as a way of accountability. But to actually measure that would be quite a lift by the city.
Pun intended. Thank you.
Alderman Rainey. Any further discussion? I'll accept the motion to receive and file the report. Or do you want to make Sorry, do you want to make your formal recommendations to staff, or just...
Mr. Chair, I'd like to move that the committee support an administrative moratorium on the requirement that if you have a medallion, you will lose it if you do not have a driver for that car.
So, well, point of procedure, I mean, I don't know if we can do that under the Open Meetings Act because we don't have an official item for consideration that was given notice.
I'm referring it to staff. Is it administrative?
Oh, so I mean, we'll consider this at the next meeting on Monday.
No, I'm referring this to... Wait, let me explain. I'm referring this not to the council. I'm referring this to staff and just asking support of the committee so that an administrative decision can be made to place a moratorium on that rescission requirement in our ordinance, which was an administrative act to begin with, I believe, taking it away. Let's just go with it and see what our legal department says.
And Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I've already indicated that we'll move forward with that moratorium.
Right.
So no need to make a formal motion.
Well, I think there is. I'd like to be on record as reminding the council that we did this.
Right.
So could I have a second?
I would second it.
Yeah, I'd ask the city attorney how this complies with the Open Meetings Act.
I'm about to challenge the ruling of the chair, so please don't do that.
Point of order. I'm asking the city attorney.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, with respect to the action that's being requested, I believe that this ties into a part of the code 3-17-3-4, subsection C, which speaks to the renewal fee. And the renewal fee has the April 1st deadline. So I think that for purposes of terminology, that's what we're all talking about. However, it's easily accomplishable that the renewal fee can be considered in context of the discussion tonight, not requiring a formal vote, and that administratively the issue of the renewal fee and non-renewal and what happens to the medallion can be dealt with pending further direction from the committee and the council.
And to
And I don't want to get the parliamentary procedure, right. But
so to further state, a moratorium is only so that plans can be made at, you know, in the meantime, to generate some legislation to cover the issue.
Mm-hmm. Correct. I mean, I think procedurally your motion is out of order, and that's just if we could. City staff has taken notice of the discussion of the committee.
As long as the substance is dealt with, I don't really care.
And Mr. City Manager, you've been listening.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I believe the committee's will has been expressed, and as the city manager, my intention is to follow that expression.
Alderman Holmes.
If I'm not mistaken, I don't want to put words into your mouth, Alderman Rainey, but I thought there was a little bit more to this in terms of us looking at our reviewing the ordinance and to see if there were ways in which we could help the taxi industry without doing anything to Uber or Lyft, but actually trying to figure out ways that we might be able to assist them in some kind of way.
Yes, I thought that reference was already approved earlier. Right. That we deal with this issue at our first meeting in May.
Oh, okay.
When we
all right.
deal with the
and I heard all that, but I thought it was going to be saved until, well, if I remember, the city manager said he wasn't so sure about taxes at that time, and that's why we were bringing it up again at the end when we were discussing this as a discussion item for the taxes and shared rides.
What I will do because we're so concerned with procedure. At the council meeting, any alderman can make a reference to any standing committee or the council, and I will do that then.
Okay.
So that there's no question that we will deal with the taxi issue if the council approves mm-hmm. it at a meeting to be scheduled the 1st of May.
And Alderman Miller, members of the committee, if that is something that the committee recommends, I'd like to at least have until the 9th. Until May the 9th, which would be the second Monday, is if we're going to convene a meeting of taxi cab license holders, I think we need more than a few days to put that together.
The next council meeting.
Next regular council meeting.
Okay,
yes.
What about the chicken and waffles thing?
And we have additional information on that, Mr. Chair, when appropriate.
Oh, right now? Okay. So, well, let's handle taxi cab. So, I mean, the formal recommendation is to consider the issue revisions to the ordinance at the May 9th meeting.
As long as the moratorium is in effect.
And we will also convene a meeting with interested parties to, as Alderman Holmes has recommended, to find out of what they would like us to do, as long as it does not in any way impact Uber and Lyft. And I think that may ultimately be the challenge for the council is what can we do without negatively impacting that. So, but we will have Mr. Munzer and Ms. Knapp will convene a meeting and we'll do that and have all that information for you on the 9th of May.
Well, since it's already been referred, this is chicken and waffles, to the council, we can have the presentation at the council, full council anyways. I'm sure they might want to hear that as well.
We've got more information on the taxes.
So. Yeah, so, I mean, let's just go ahead in that regard. So I'll accept a motion to adjourn. Second? Is there a second? Thank you. We're adjourned. Well, the city council will be convened in 10 minutes at 10 to 8.